Welcome to the Real Revenue Show, a show about real business concepts that will help and grow and scale any business model. We're your hosts. I'm Malcom Bowser. This is Andre Trust. Now, sorry for, I'm in my home office today. You know what I mean? Not in the office. But as you can see, I have my bookcase in the background, which will be something integral into what we're talking about today. So, Andre, welcome.
What's going on, my brother?
Good, man. How was your week?
It was long, man. It was a good week, though. I had a perspective change again. You know, I'm big on perspective changes. Earlier this year, I ended up losing one of my top guys. Yeah, it came to me and was just saying, hey, Andre, I'm at the point where I think I want to branch out on my own. And I told him, I said, you know what? I completely understand that. I go into business with the concept that I'm never going to have an employee the whole time. Mm-hmm. And that with the things that I'm teaching them, they're going to be able to go branch out on their own at some point.
Right.
So I was like, all right, cool. But, he was leaving at an integral point. I'm like, all right, but I understand as a man, I understood where he was coming from. He wanted to go stand on his own. And that's something that I could never, take away from him or not allow him to kind of do. So he goes off on his own. And, I see his girlfriend the other day. And I was just saying, there's this breakfast place I go to all the time. Mm. I'm the worst. They know me in there. They're like, hey, Andre, your usual. Yeah. I walk in. It's like everything's already set up. I'm like a creature of habit. And I see his girlfriend and she's like, yo, he's doing amazing. Like X, Y, and Z. So I decided to hit him up. I'm like, hey, what's going on, brother? It's been a while. I heard you're doing really big things. I'm super excited. And he kind of just talked to me about the fact that the things that he's doing, he really appreciates us for. Mm-hmm. And it didn't dawn on me that everything that he's doing, I trained him. Mm. I trained him on. So he's scaling his team. He's doing all of these things. And it warmed my heart in such a way that I can't imagine. It was different because he's my guy. That's really my friend. Mm. I really appreciate him. He came in and we really molded him and got him to the next level. But obviously, I'm going to be sad that he's gone.
Right.
Because I spent so much time, I was like, sad that he's left. I wasn't mad or disappointed or anything. I was just sad like any person would be.
Right.
So, but just to see him flourishing the way that he was, I couldn't help but just be happy. And then I ran back to my partner and I'm like, yo, he's doing really well. And he attributes these things to us. And me and, my partner, we work so hard on trying to help the people around us.
Right.
That sometimes we don't notice that we're actually helping the people around us.
Right.
Because in our mind, we try to pour so much into people that, we don't really see it because we're in it.
Yeah.
And it isn't until somebody else goes on their own or goes and does their thing on their own that it's like, hey, you are an integral part in their right. growth. And that was just, it was so dope for me, man. I got a renewed sense of strength this week. I got a renewed sense of energy and it just was really dope to see, another person under my tutelage, living by the words, standing on those principles and actually, taking those things and going to fend for themselves and being able to provide for their family and provide for their friends and provide for, their future kids and things like that. It's a very dope feeling. So that was my perspective change for the week. I went from being sad about it, dang, mm-hmm. I lost my guy to, yo, he's killing it.
Right.
And it's that was the point all along. So the fact that he could stand on his own, that's the real win. I thought that was pretty dope.
Dope.
What about you? What's going on with you?
So it actually lines up with our topic today because today we're going to be talking about building authority. And what's the word that you used?
Credibility.
Credibility. Building authority and credibility. And a lot when we talk about people who are trying to build businesses, or we spoke last week about coaching and mentorship, and a lot of these people, they have a real false sense of authority and a real and not a lot of credibility at all. And this week, again, I was just telling you before we started shooting, for a while, I was just starting to read books and business books for the sake of reading business books. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To the point where it was hard for me to actually get through a whole book because my mind was so fractured. My focus was so fractured on other things I was trying to do. And I couldn't find particular books that were actually focused on my current goal, right? So I recently found a few books that were actually on my current goal, and it really kind of like reinvigorated me to get like my learning back on again. Like I feel like I'm studying in school again, and it feels really good because I've always loved school. You know what I'm saying? You know, I know how you feel about school too. Like we are learning and getting better at things. So when we talk about building credibility, where do you feel like a person should start?
So there's a couple key components, right, that I always try to get across, right? No matter what business you're in, it's always going to be sales, right? People misunderstand business a lot, right? You're always in the market of selling something, mm-hmm. no matter what, whether you're selling yourself, whether you're selling a product, whether you're, you know, you're selling, you know, a course or anything, you're always in the process of selling yourself, right? So credibility really starts with understanding what you're selling, right? How can you sell something if you don't know everything about it, right? So it starts with, you know, that knowledge portion of what you were mentioning.
Right.
Is, you know, coming into the game, understanding that people work with who they trust. So how can I trust somebody if they don't have the knowledge that somebody who is in that field should have? Mm-hmm. So similar to, like, let's say, for instance, a doctor. Imagine going into a doctor's office and you're like, hey, you know, I have this lump on my shoulder. And the doctor's like, oh, you know, lumps happen. Mm-hmm. And it's like, you don't know why the lump is there.
Right.
it's kind of like the credibility is immediately lost. People think credibility comes from just being out there. Credibility really comes from competence and knowledge.
Right.
That's, you know, that's missed a lot. You know, I'll see people put out a new product or start a new business. And my first question is like, you know, where's your like FAQ? Or like, what's the questions that people would ask?
Right.
Right. Because if you could answer those questions up front, then it's like, oh, this person already know their product so well that they know what I'm going to ask.
Right.
Right. So it's just starting off with that knowledge base and really trying to understand yourself, understand the product, and being able to really stand on what that product did or whatever your business or service is. From your standpoint, what do you deem authority or credibility as?
So when I look for, when I'm introduced to somebody and they have a product or a service that they claim they can help me with, you know, solving an issue or, you know, a problem, the thing I look for credibility is if they actually do what they're trying to help me with. You get what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
And I mean, like, have done, and it doesn't really have to be at an extremely high level, but to the point where, like, how long have you been doing this? Because there are people who, and, you know, the show, me and my pops, we call them YouTube scholars. You know what I'm saying? Like, they go on YouTube.
Are you a YouTube scholar?
YouTube scholar. You know what I mean? They go on YouTube, they watch a few videos and just kind of regurgitate what they hear, but not really understanding that in the field, whatever field it is, in the field, you run into certain nuances that cannot really be taught, or you can't really learn from just hearing it. You get what I'm saying? You're in real estate. I'm sure there's certain things that have happened that if somebody was to tell you, you wouldn't have been able to get the full picture than actually being in it.
Exactly.
You get what I'm saying? So yeah. I think about that all the time when it comes to credibility, because especially now and in YouTube social media era, it is rampant with people who create these fake narratives or these fake stories about themselves and try to sell themselves as an expert when they're not. They actually have like zero credibility, and it bothers me. I'm not gonna lie to you, especially when I feel like I've taken my lumps. You know what I mean? I've read the material I've needed to read, but I've also been out there taking my lumps in podcasting and YouTubing and printing shirts and things like that. Like, I've taken my lumps. I've lost money. Stuff has failed. You get what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I know the certain nuances that it takes to have a successful podcast, have a successful shirt business, the do's and don'ts to do this. How what happens when you initially don't sell your book and now you put in place the right marketing plan to sell your book, things like that. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. My mentor, So I'm a part of Omega Sci-Fi Fraternity Incorporated.
Shouts out to you. You just had your founders day too. Shouts out to y'all.
Appreciate you. Appreciate you. So, but one of my mentors, real good dude. I love him to death. I ain't gonna say his name because he a private dude as well. But, you know, just took me under his wing. One of the things he used to say to me, he'd say, and he's from New York, real like big dude. His demeanor is larger than life. Vocabulary is unmatched. Like I've never, like a powerful orator, like can take you to any emotion that I can possibly imagine. So, you know, he'd say to me, hey, Andre, other people read the first line. We read the entire book. Right. And I was just like, I'm cool, old head. Like, appreciate you. Like, I'm not really focused on that. But as I got more into stuff, going back to what you were saying about people on YouTube, and you could tell that they just read the headline on anything. But you just having a 5-minute convo and seeing where that convo goes can tell whether or not somebody is credible in that field or not by the ability to go in depth on a topic. Right. And have a stance on a position. Set up a position, be able to structure that position and be able to defend points on that, you know, position.
Right.
Like I'll ask some people like, okay, you mentioned that. So I do a lot of debates, bro. That's one of my favorite things. To all of our, you know, guests and family on the show, you know, if you ever want to have a debate with me, I would love to. I love different perspectives for real. Like I'm big on perspectives. And if you can prove to me that something is wrong, I'll adopt it. And Malk will attest to that. I'm like one of the most humble dudes you will ever meet. If you can, but you got to prove to me though.
Right.
Right. But if you can prove to me that something is incorrect or that I'm thinking about something incorrectly, I will abandon the way that I'm thinking in order to think in the best manner. Mm-hmm. Right. So I'll have debates a lot. And one of the things I normally ask is like, where do you get that information from? Right. And it's like, where'd you get that information from? There's only a few ways to get information. Either you're going to get it from a credible source or you're going to take your lumps like you mentioned. And it's like, yeah, bro, I'm qualified to talk on this because I lost $20,000.
Right.
Doing it the way that you think is correct. Like
right.
that is a valid stance point. Right. And people trust that and people appreciate that. Right. Mm-hmm. Because I think we're in the day and age now where people are realizing that everyone, this whole perfect culture is fake. Like that is just not real.
Right.
One of the things as an entrepreneur, if you can realize as early as possible that it's all trial and error, you're going to be in the greatest position ever once you realize like, hey, it's all about failing, but failing extremely fast and extremely aggressively so I could just move on.
Right.
Right. And the more I can put myself out there and the more I called it building your social credibility score. Right. That matters a lot because who am I trying to think about? There's a word that I use a lot called omnipresence, right? Anybody that's around me long enough will hear me use that term omnipresence, right? Which is the act of being everywhere all at once.
Right.
And the reason that I use that is because when you're getting ready to launch a product or getting ready to stand on the service that you're building or ready to sell yourself, even like, you know, anybody that's on here that wants, you know, better tactics for even their job or their, like, you know, being in the workplace, because workplace is another entrepreneurial playground that people don't understand as well. It's very easy to make it up the ranks in the workplace if you know how to make it up the ranks.
Right.
It's exceptionally easy. You know, omnipresence is it. You need to be everywhere, right? Because how do you become a subject matter expert is to become the subject matter expert. You have to learn about it, talk about it, breathe about it, be in the rooms with the people that's talking about it, contribute to the conversation, and give to the topic, right? So I'm, my big, hairy, audacious goal, you'll hear that in everything, like what is your bag, right? My big, hairy, audacious goal is I want to be a thought leader in the business space, right? I want when people think of business, they're like, oh, Andre's one of those guys.
Right.
That his word is strong, right? So how do I get to that journey? I have to build credibility, right? So the things that I give away for free, and you had mentioned this, right?
Yes.
The stuff, and I think our on one of our last episodes, the things that you give away for free need to be so good that it's like, oh, whatever the paid version of that is
right.
is probably like, I can't even imagine what the paid version is like.
Right, right.
You know, so that's where I'm at now is trying to get people to understand that credibility isn't an option. That is a must for longevity, right? You need to have people look at you as a subject matter expert and they need to view you, right? So even if it's a year, 2, 3 years, which sucks, mm-hmm. you just putting out information, being in that space, being contributing to the conversation and being a part of that combo, when the time comes for you to make a sale, everybody's going to look back and be like, okay, who is this guy?
Right.
Oh, wait, he's been going since 2017 on this topic.
Right.
Oh, you know, dang, this guy really knows what he's talking about. Oh, he has businesses. He has X or he has this or, you know, whatever space you're in, he's done this. Examples like, you know, I'm always going to make a plug for you, by the way. I love it. But you're getting ready to I know I'm like putting your business out yeah. there, but it is what it is. Right. Like you're getting ready to put out, you know, potential like your podcast course and then your YouTube course. It's like, well, bro, you've done like 300 plus episodes of podcasting, YouTube, like the epitome of this guy has done it. Right. So if I'm going to make a purchase, why would I not make a purchase from, you know, the guy that has done visibly 300 plus shows?
And that's another thing. Like, I feel like for you to create like authentic credibility, there has to be a visible footprint. Meaning, like you said, like the videos are up. You get what I'm saying? you can go on YouTube, you can go on Apple Podcasts, like the videos and podcasts are up. Mm-hmm. They're actually services. And I don't know if you even noticed, they're services to where they'll create a press release for you, right? Mm-hmm. And get your press release somehow, just a press release somehow into like Forbes, Business Insider, stuff like that. Just get them in there for you. So now technically you've been in Forbes, you've been in Business Insider. You go to their site and then you'll see the logo, the Forbes logo, the Business Insider, like the entrepreneur logo on their site, like as seen in.
Yeah.
And that creates, again, the false sense of credibility. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it's you see how it's important it is, because people are trying to cheat their way into having some credibility, but there's so many ways that people actually cheat. It's so crazy to me. So like, I feel like there needs to be an actual footprint somehow, some mm-hmm. way, either with the people you've dealt with, like, you know, referrals and stuff like that, mm-hmm. or like past business dealings, or like online somewhere. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because how would you know? Right. This is one of the things I often ask, like, how do you know these people are doing what they say that they're doing? Right. When in a day and age where Photoshop is so real at this point, bro, like you can't tell what's not real.
Exactly.
So now we're at that point in the history where anything could be created out of thin air. How do we prove? Right. Like this is the example I was using the other day. I was having another debate and we were saying that I'm big on data and statistics, right? So I was looking up like the statistics on rappers, mm-hmm. statistics on basketball, all sports, football, hockey, like everything that I can find, right? And in the total like history of like the NBA, there's been like 4,000 players, right? Or something like that, like yeah. just 4,000 players, right? So if there's 4,000 players and there's what, 6 to 7 billion people on the earth, right? The likelihood of achieving the NBA is so slim
yeah.
that it's almost like being hit by lightning. Like right. you have almost a better chance of being hit by lightning than you do as a average person who is not a freak of nature in terms of physicality
right.
to be able to play, right? Similar with music, right? Across the board and everything, country music, rap, mm-hmm. You know, R&B, you have a better chance, right? Like even if we look now, at like how many artists are really making what we call the bag, right? It's like the labels have these budgets, right? So I always boil it back down to what is allowing people to put this stuff out, right? So they're trying to build a sense of credibility to reel you in on everything. Everything mm-hmm. is about, okay, what can I show you that is going to bring you into the way that I'm thinking and allow me to make a sale to you?
Right.
Right. So credibility is understanding that circle of trust and understanding that, okay, if I bring people into where I'm at, how do I get them to stay there? And it's the trust component.
Yeah.
So I was using the hip hop and all of those things to show like, that's just one form, but they're able to put a bunch of things in front of us that you would think is actually more than not. Right. So because the way we think about the NBA or the way you would think about hip hop, it's almost like those things are very attainable. Actually, they're not attainable.
Right.
It's actually very difficult. In fact, right. But having that visor or that screen put in front of us is what gets the credibility of those businesses in place for you to want to hunt it down and for them to be able to pick out the best talents. So credibility is in everything that, you know, everything that we do in that sense and trying to, you know, figure that portion out.
That's a fact. I remember I was, when I was writing my book, shameless plug, Urban Excellence, right? You can get it anywhere.
That's a good book, by the way. That's a good book.
So I was interviewing my brother and I thought like his story was super important to include in the book because I wanted to show the fact that
I was like, I feel like this is on my shelf.
I wanted to show the fact that, like I said, you have to kind of go through your lumps. Now, the chapter, my brother's chapter is called Falling Forward because he went through a period in his life when he's trying these business projects out and then they just not working out. But he's learned so much from each one of those failures to the point where he told me in the book, and it's there, he told me he, like, if ever, like, rarely works with people who say they've never failed at something.
Yeah,
because he takes that process so seriously of going through whatever you have to go through to become successful that if you say you never failed, he goes, all right, something's wrong with this person. He's lying,
yeah.
And he's untrustworthy, and I don't need to work with him anyway. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Especially like with social media now, you can rent a Bentley and say, I got this Bentley from this business. So, and then, but the psychology of people who fall for those things is interesting as well. You know what I'm saying?
You know, what's crazy, bro. So this is what I'll say, right? And I'll charge everybody who's listening to take an opportunity in 2022 to really focus on the science of people. Deep dive. Remember I told y'all I was done kind of reading business books for a while.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I've been reading the other types of books, just blatant science.
Yeah.
Of like how we're made up. And the truth is we're actually very easily manipulated. Because we have an unconscious brain that 98% of people, if not 99% of people, will never try to tap into. And that unconscious brain, it's such a powerful, like, you know, and this is a plug for like science, right? Science is huge because we're at a point where people don't understand how intricate they are. Like us being created is a scientific marvel.
Facts. I look at my son all the time, like, yo, like, look at you, you're here.
It's a scientific marvel. I was talking to my boy Eric, right? And I had just read it. So I was like, all right, let me see if I could go explain this. I said, bro, I see you just went to the bathroom. You know, did you know that we're made up of like 70% of water? He was like, yeah, I knew that. I was like, okay, right? But because we're made up of 70% of water, there needs to be a regulator in our body that like is like a checks and balance of keeping it at 70.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, what is the checks and balance? So your kidney is the checks and balances of keeping it at 70. So when it's below 70%, it actually sends like a like neurotoxin throughout your body. I'm not sure if that was the correct term, by the way, but it sends something.
Neurosignal.
That might be better. So it sends a neurosignal throughout your body that triggers thirst. So then you're like, oh dang, why do I feel so thirsty right now? And it's like, yeah, bro, it's because you're not at 70%. We need to get back to 70% immediately. And then when you're above 70%, it's like, I really need to use the bathroom, but your pee will be that much clearer because you're actually getting rid of water versus waste.
Right.
Right. So the clearer your pee is, you're getting. And I'm like, this was like a chapter in. And I was like, all right, I got to close the book.
Yeah.
Because I'm not, I will say this, I am not a scientist. This is something that I'm just intrigued by. So, you know, if I did mess up on some of the terms and things like that, this is not my wheelhouse.
Don't attack us in the comments.
Best believe in 1 year, though, I will be back with the proper knowledge and terminology for it, because I'm now learning how powerful our minds are. And the people who are in these roles have studied these things.
Mm-hmm.
So they're like, oh, people actually have a hard propensity to like to say yes. It's actually very difficult to continuously say no.
Yeah.
So if I can just get you in a way where it's difficult as a hardwire for you to say no, then naturally you're gonna say yes. I can take advantage of that.
Right.
I'm like, oh wow.
But I remember this one guy that he talked about how it's easier to get people away from pain than it is to pleasure. I'm gonna explain, right? Mm-hmm. So he goes, yo, this guy named Myron Golden, dude is deep. He goes,
the goat.
He said, if I stand on the corner with $100 bill and say, I'm giving away this $100 bill, anybody want this $100 bill? He said, most people will look at me like, what the hell is wrong with that $100 bill? You know what I'm saying? Like, mind you, this is the pleasure. This $100 bill is the pleasure. But I'm saying here, most people will go like, yo, what the hell? And walk right past me. Like, this dude must be crazy. Like, what the hell is that? Right? Mm-hmm. But let's say if you just got into a car accident, right, and you need help, you're going to go to the next closest person to you to help you because you're trying to get away from pain.
Okay, so okay, okay.
Anybody who is offering that, who could possibly offer help, because
I never thought about it that way.
Yo, my mind was blown. You know what I'm saying?
That does make sense because, so now I understand it. So now that goes back into the terminology of why, oh, I got the Lambo or I got the house, is because somebody that's in poverty or in real painful situation is like, oh, wow, bro.
Exactly. You know what I'm saying? Exactly. I was like, wow, okay. So like a lot of this stuff is psychology, especially getting back to credibility. I feel like because becoming like a thought leader and things like that seem attractive, a lot of people and I think it is attractive, and I think it is important. Like, we do need thought leaders. We do need different people who coach businesses, who coach these certain topics for different perspective, because different strokes for different folks, you know what I'm saying? But I don't think people understand that there does need to be a grind period.
Yes.
There does need to be a grind period. You are a Marine. Like, you did have to go to boot camp. You get what I mean? Like, you did have to go through what you had to go through to say, I confidently am who I am. You know what I'm saying? And I think when people like realize that, I think they will be in a better position. That's just me.
One of the things I like to, so once again, I'm always going to drive home, right? Data, we should be fighting over getting data. So I had asked my buddy the question, so I'll ask you the same question. When, for males, when do men tend to reach like their peak earnability or earnings capability?
Earnings, that's 35.
Bro, 55 years old.
Wow, okay.
55 years old.
And this is based off what?
And just like peak earnability, just across the board, just average.
Okay.
Right? Peak earnings occur around 55. Right? And then I'm like, okay, why is it 55? Well, it's because people tend to really get into their career at about 25. So you really need a solid like 20 to 30 years of pain to be viewed as like, you know what? That guy really knows what he's talking about.
Right.
So I equate that a lot because social media will make you think that everyone at 27 is a millionaire.
Right.
The statistics, the actual the actual data would actually disagree with that. and show that a lot of people are actually, it's false. Mm-hmm. Right? But I'm trying to get back. I'm trying to have people understand that the journey is okay. There's nothing wrong with the journey, and that the journey is fun, because when you get to the age of being the OG, it's worth it.
Yeah.
Right. Because now it's okay. One day, every day, I'm just trying to get better than the guy or girl I was yesterday.
Right.
That's all I'm trying to do. Like, the guy or girl, I want everybody to focus on that. Like, guy or girl yesterday, just be better than that person. Mm-hmm. Because I was doing some reflecting. I actually woke up this morning in a deep reflective mood. And I listened to this poem I had wrote when I was like 16. And I had set a line in it where I was saying, like, you know, the dreams that I'm chasing, I one day hope to attain. You know, I was talking about laying on the floor and visualizing my future. And I looked up and realized that every single thing in that poem I've achieved. And it tripped me out because I'm like, and I didn't even notice it.
Right.
And it's because, like, my whole premise has always been, I just want to be better than Andre of yesterday. And if I could just be better than that dude, not anyone else, no one else. I don't want to view anyone else, because we're in that period now where we're not designed to be able to know what everyone's doing. We're not designed for that. Once again, this is pure science.
At all.
Okay? We have jealousy as a natural emotion inside of people, or a natural state of being. So now we're feeding that natural state of being every single day by posting people's highlights online. And then they're creating false narratives, which then creates false credibility, which then takes away from your real credibility, which makes you feel less than. Mm-hmm. We're not designed for that at all. In fact, that's very detrimental to us. So I don't focus on anyone else. And I really focus on just being more credible, just better than Andre of yesterday. And this morning was me finally realizing that I woke up at 28 and I'm way better than Andre of 16 ever imagined. Like when I was saying that, I had envisioned like the basic version.
Yeah.
And now I'm like, wow, like I'm at actually like Andre, like 6.0 compared to the version that of the person that I wanted to be, which is dope because I'm 28. Right. Mm-hmm. I was looking up ages, right? It's another thing too. I want people to start just looking into people's ages, right? The average age for presidency is like what?
50, 60, maybe?
I think it's like 60 to 70, bro.
Yeah, I think Barack, he was young when he won.
Yeah, I think he was like the young guy.
Young, yeah.
Everybody else is like 70 to 80.
Right.
And I'm looking up these guys and I'm like, something's off here. Let me ask him questions. You know how I am. I get in questions mode. So I started calling old people I knew. And I was like, hey, like, now that you're older, like, how do you feel? Do you feel less capable? Do you feel? And all of the performers I knew at like 65, 70 were all like, yo, I don't feel any different from being 28. Mm-hmm. In my mental, the only difference is like my body really hurts.
Right.
But mental sharpness, I can log a 18-hour day with a 28-year-old easily. Mm. And I'm just like, okay, so why am I in a rush then? Because if at 63, 65, and 70, as long as I'm in the gym,
right,
I work out, I eat, and I keep myself healthy,
right,
then at those age, at that age, I'll have thousands of people that I've built relationships with. Mm-hmm. I'll have money saved over these years. I'll have the credibility that I want. And for legacy wise, if I want to leave something behind, I could be 60 years old, mm-hmm, hit a lick at 61 be really good.
Right.
So now I'm in the phase of trying to get people to understand that we view ourselves like in the middle, right? This is how like Malcolm and I really view ourselves, right? And there's always going to be an equal set in terms of the people that we associate with, an equal set of people below us, and an equal set of people above us, which is where being humble comes into play. Because the moment you look down and be like, oh, I'm better than that person, you look up and realize there's just as many people who are looking down at you, which right. creates that feeling of, oh, all right, yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and humble myself.
Right.
Because there's levels to money across the board for anything. There's levels everything. To business, there's levels to everything. So the goal is trying to get through this journey of life being as honest as possible. Mm-hmm. And that honesty builds that credibility. And when you build that credibility, you're then able to leverage that credibility into dollars and cents mm-hmm. in a way that's able to help you and benefit you. So that's something I'm really trying to push this year.
So I actually want to leave people with two books I think they should read that kind of go directly to what you were talking about. One is Mastery by Robert Greene. And he talks about the importance of apprenticeship. And a lot of the people that we study in history, I'm a history buff, a lot of people we study in history, we don't realize they were in their own whatever apprenticeship for like 20 years. You know what I'm saying? And we don't hear about that, but we just hear about the great things they've done. Mm-hmm. So read about mastery, and it talks about actually mastering your craft, whatever it is, and how mm-hmm. long it actually takes. We heard about if you read Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell, the 10,000 hour rule, stuff like that. Yeah. And he goes very in depth. That's a great book as well. And another book I will want people to read is Atomic Habits by James Clear. And it talks about he gave a story about this cycling team who went from the worst on the planet to one of the best because their coach got them 1% better every day. And that's all it really took to create a compounding effect to where that they were like one of the top cycling teams on the planet. So Mastery by Robert Greene, Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell, great book, and Atomic Habits by James Clear. I think everybody should read that.
And toss in the compound effect.
The compound effect, amazing.
Yeah, like that just brings it full circle.
Definitely.
Because that feeling of just like, blatantly just who was this person yesterday and how can I be better than them? Right. I worked out for 30 minutes yesterday. Today I'm going to work out for 32 minutes.
Exactly.
It's tough to see because it's hard because you're in it. I was talking with, my buddy this morning. Mm-hmm. That was a big thing. I'm like, hey man, like I was having that reflective moment and I couldn't realize any of it because I have no perspective on myself.
Right.
But that's because I wasn't analyzing myself and looking at the people who I was, like the person who I was, right? Because you're different and you should be wanting to be different.
Facts.
I'm not the old Andre. I can't recognize that kid. Mm. But he was a person who I know intimately, and I'm better than that guy.
Right.
Just like 45-year-old Andre is gonna be like, yo, little 28-year-old Andre was, I don't know who that guy is.
Exactly.
And you should be trying to change. And it's like you were saying, it's just all you need is 1%. You don't need the 100% out the gate. You just need to stay down one foot in front of the other. Do you listen to Jason Peterson or Jordan Peterson? I said Jason Peterson.
You put me on him. I have his book up there right now.
So Jordan Peterson mentions this. He's like, I just every day that I get home, I just focus on one thing that can make my life better. Just one thing. Whether it's like, for me, the mornings are annoying. So I lay my clothes out for the next day. Mm-hmm. Right. So instead of waking up and then I'm tired and I'm groggy and like, now I got to go pick out an outfit, try it on. And like, I'm not knowing what meetings I'm in. I just look at my calendar. Mm-hmm. I'm like, okay, I have three meetings. Or if I don't have any meetings, it's sweats day. Mm-hmm. No meetings, no interactions, sweats. Yeah. It's good to go. But if I do have meetings, it's like, okay, I need to look good for those meetings. Hang it up the night before. Then I wake up and it's just one little thing. It's nothing crazy. Just one little thing. I adopted that. And I'm like, okay, well, I actually really hate when I'm getting ready to go to bed and I got to turn the light off.
Right.
So then I installed like Alexa lights. So now it's like, I'm like, Alexa, turn the lights off and the lights go off. And I'm like, all right, just one little thing that makes your life better. And I look for those small things everywhere. So I'll leave on that note, my brother.
All right. So we're going to leave you guys with that. Definitely check out those books and really try to internalize what we've talked about here. I'm Malcolm. This is Andre. This has been the Real Revenue Show. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe. If you're listening right now on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, wherever, don't forget to leave us a rating and a comment. We appreciate you guys, and we will see you next week. Peace.